we as a church have been going through the Bible, and we are going through the book of Matthew. So today we arrive at a fresh chapter, Matthew chapter 6, which introduces us to a new segment in this sermon that Jesus has been preaching. This sermon is called the Sermon on the Mount. We come to this fresh section called piety or true piety. Piety is about doing religious works that are meant to glorify God, that expresses our love for God. Pious acts. And here in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is going to focus on three religious activities or religious acts that are meant to glorify God, that are meant to be expressions of our love for God. He's going to talk about, number one, giving. Giving to the poor in particular. This is something that is meant to glorify God, something that pleases God. Number two, we're going to look at praying. It's all found in Matthew 6, verses 1 to 18. This is about giving to the poor, praying, and lastly, the one that Singaporeans don't like the most, fasting, all right? These three are religious acts that the Jewish people are very familiar with. We know that because, for example, in Luke chapter 18, you read about this Pharisee. A Pharisee is a religious leader during the times of Jesus. So a Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes, tenths of all that I get. So in this passage, you see what the Jewish mindset is very focused on. They're focused on three religious activities: praying, fasting, giving. So that's what Jesus is going to highlight as examples for true piety. This morning, we are just going to look at one of the three, and that is giving, in particular, giving to the poor. There's a story told of a lady who was in a concert. It was the last performance, last act, and it was done, and so everybody was applauding the performance. In particular, she noticed there were two men. Actually, there were the two ushers. The two ushers stood up and gave a rousing applause. They were very animated. They got everyone to stand up and give her applause. And she was very impressed. She was so impressed that even the ushers were so passionate about the performance. Until she heard one of the ushers said to the other, hey, get more people to get up and applaud and clap louder, because if they clap louder, they will do an encore, and if they do an encore, we'll have overtime pay. Sometimes people can do the nicest things for all the wrong reasons. And so there may be people who are very pious, at least outwardly, in giving to the poor, in praying, and even in fasting, but they can do it for all the wrong reasons, for selfish reasons. And that's what Jesus is talking about. He says in verse 1, beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father, from your God who is in heaven. So he says, be careful that you can do the nicest things for all the wrong reasons. Now, Jesus is not saying you cannot do these righteous acts before men or in public. He's not saying that. Certainly, we can pray in public. This morning, I just prayed in public. Nothing wrong with praying in public or even giving in public. The problem is when you do these things to be seen of men. So he's not against the act. He's against the attitude behind it. It's not about the action of giving. It's about the motivation of giving. It's about the heart. Why do you do what you do? These people he's warning about are doing things not because they love the poor, but because they want to be seen of men. Why do they want to be seen of men? Verse 2 tells us, so that they may be having the praise of men. So they do all these religious-looking things, very pious-looking, very devout, but actually they don't love God. They love themselves. It was all a show. It was all a performance. It was all meant to bring attention to oneself. So these people, these Pharisees actually, when they give to the needy, they will sound some trumpet before you. Well, actually, you can't prove it from history that the Pharisees actually did that. So maybe there wasn't, but Jesus was using a pictorial language. It's a very graphic language. When you want to give to someone, don't blow your own trumpet. Pa, 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 pa. Look at me, I'm going to give. No, don't ever do that. Don't draw attention to yourself. Because if you do so, you are a hypocrite. Now, the word hypocrite for us today obviously has taken on a very negative connotation. Oh, you're a hypocrite. Nobody likes to be called a hypocrite. It's a negative thing. Pretentious and so on. Well, actually, the word hypocrite in the original Greek simply means actor, stage actor. So an actor comes up on stage and he acts. He plays a role. He pretends to be someone he is not. And his whole goal is to make you be so convinced that what he's doing is that of another persona, isn't it? As an actor. A good actor makes you believe he really is that guy. So this word is used to describe the Pharisees. They pretend to be someone they are not. They don't really love the poor. They don't really love God. They really don't care about those who are needy. All they want is to make you believe that they are one like that. They pretend. And in those days, Greek actors, they use masks. Phantom of the, wrong example, not Phantom of the Opera. But they use masks, all right? And if they want you to believe that this character is an angry character, they use an angry mask. Happy character, use a happy mask. And if they want you to think that they are a religious, pious, devout people, they use this mask. They look pious by giving to the needy, asking you to see. But actually behind that mask is a man who doesn't care about the poor. So Jesus said, when you give to the poor, don't put up this show. Don't be a hypocrite. He's condemning those who have absolutely no regard for the poor, but are just using the plight of the poor to advance themselves. You know how wicked that is? You're using the plight of the poor, not because you love them, but you use their plight to advance your own reputation and name. You're using money to buy the applause of men. You don't love God, but you want people to think you love God. But that's the entire problem right here. So Jesus said, beware. This is what the Pharisees are doing, but this can also be what the children of God can do. After all, that's why he gave this Sermon on the Mount. It's given to the disciples. It's given to Christians. It's given to believers of God. He says, don't think that this heart of hypocrisy is only for the Pharisees or for people who do not know God. This is equally a temptation for Christians. I've been a Christian for 20 over years, and I certainly see in my heart this temptation to draw attention to myself. Oh yeah, there are times where I love God, I truly want to serve Him, but you know, there are many times where maybe my heart is mixed, also with this mixed motive, that I want people to see, I want people to know, I want people to hear of what I have done. That's something to be careful about. And that's why some people serve. That's why some people give. That's why some people pray. They use very religious words. Oh, this cheap King James English for a long, long time, just so that you can be impressed with how spiritual he sounds. Well, we all are vulnerable. That's why Jesus says, be careful of how you give. Beware of doing this before men in order to have the praise of men. It's a real temptation. You can give for all kinds of reasons. A story is told of two men who were stranded on an island. One man was very nervous. Oh no, we're going to die on this island. No one's going to save us. We are marooned off here. And then another guy is very chill, very relaxed. He just lies on the beach, enjoy the suntan, and was absolutely calm. So the man was very kanchiong, asking, how come you can be so calm? We're going to die in this island, you know. The man says, no, we won't. Someone will come and save us. How do you know that? Well, I make a lot of money. I make $100,000 a month, and I give regularly to the church, so my pastor will definitely come and find me. Some people give so that others may see and others will remember. Well, Jesus says, be careful of doing this. Be careful of how you give. Why? Because if you do this to be seen of men, then you have no reward from your Father. You're already paid. You did all that pretentious work. You acted. People gave you that applause. People said, wow, you're very godly. You already got paid. No more reward in heaven. Sorry, paid once, you're not going to be paid twice. So, the problem here is a heart of hypocrisy, and it is a precaution that Jesus is giving to us. What's his prescription? What's his solution? Well, he says in verse 3, but when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. This is cool. When you give it in such a way, nobody will notice it. I mean, that's very clear, right? Give it in such a way that your wife doesn't know it. Give it in such a way that your care group doesn't know it. Give it such a way that your friends don't know it. Give it in such a way that your family doesn't know it. Just give so that no one knows. That's the best way to give. Giving quietly, unobtrusively, unpretentiously, in such a way that even you yourself will forget about it very quickly. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand gave. Don't keep track of what you gave. You know, well, God, I give you how much? Next year, you better give me something. No, you give in such a way, I gave. I don't want to think too much about it. It's a privilege to give to God, to give to serve the poor in the name of God. It's a wonderful privilege to do so, and I do not want people to know, I don't even want myself to praise myself by remembering what I have given. That's, I think, the idea here. A story is told of Charles Spurgeon. As some of you would know, he's a pastor who lived about 200 years ago. In those days, he had a chicken. And apparently the chicken laid a lot of eggs. And he sold all the eggs and got a handsome profit out of the eggs. And people were criticizing Spurgeon for selling the eggs. Because he says, wow, they say, you have so many eggs, you have made such a profit, you should have given the profit to the poor. You should have given it away. Why do you make all the profit and you keep it for yourself? Amazing how people criticized last time, even eggs. But it went on that he and his wife said nothing about the event. They did not defend themselves. They did not answer the criticism at all. And it was only after the death of his wife that it was found out that all the profits from selling the eggs were used solely to support two elderly widows. And the reason Spurgeon didn't want to defend the case, he didn't want to answer the criticism, is because he doesn't want people to know what he gave. He doesn't want the left hand to know what the right hand gave. Andrew Bonar, a pastor, a theologian in time past, says the best part of all Christian work is that part which only God sees. Probably the most glamorous guy here in this church today is me. I'm standing here. What everyone sees. And everyone probably assumes he is such a godly man. Wow. Until you talk to my wife. No, he's not such a godly man. There are many godly people around who do many, many acts of service to God unknown and unseen by anyone else. One day, those who believe in Jesus, we're all going to be in heaven, and you'll see those, wow, I didn't know you're so far in front. Pastor, I didn't know you're so far behind. You don't know. We like to judge now from what we can see. But God sees all our works and he sees all our motivations. And that will be an interesting day. But this is so encouraging. Because when you give to the poor, when you give to the needy, when you serve others, and you're not drawing attention to yourself, and you may even have forgotten what you've given, God tracks all that. He rewards those who serve him. So, he says, give to the needy in such a way that your left hand doesn't know your right hand, what it has done. Give in such a secretive, quiet way, and then your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Now, this is a word from God. This is a promise from God. Not what I say. If I say, you say, bopake. But from God himself, he says he will reward those who give in secret. Whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will repay him for his deed. And again, in Hebrews chapter 6, for God is not unjust, so as to overlook your work and the love that you have shown for his name in serving the saints as you still do. So, you may say, Pastor never see I give leh. Church never see I give leh. That's not the point. You give in such a way that no one sees. Then God will make sure you are rewarded. All right? You want the reward of men or you want the reward of God? I think that's clear. Now, it's very tempting to want the applause of men. That's how twisted we are. We love attention on ourselves. But trust God's word, serve him in a quiet way. Sometimes even if you are called to serve him in a public way, do it with a pure motive as best as you can, not for attention, not for fame, not for reputation, but for the glory of God, and you will never regret it in eternity. So that's the exposition of the text. What time is it? Okay, 9:45. So I think you'll stone me if I end here. You say, wow, you're so lazy, you never do anything. So, to please men, okay. Oh, but no, seriously, I have a few concluding thoughts, all right? The exposition is simple, but just a few concluding thoughts. Three, as is normal. Number one, I want to remind all of us about the importance of giving. Here, it's about giving to the poor. All right? The importance of giving to the poor. Now, it's not about you giving to church, all right? Some of you, wow, first time I'm coming to church, this church talk about money, give to church. No. I think this is about giving to the poor. It may be about people who are in church, but it can refer also to people outside church. Doesn't matter. The principle is a true believer of the Lord Jesus Christ wants to and will give to the poor. It's important. This is something that is way from the beginning. In the book of Deuteronomy, that's the first five books of the Bible, the fifth book, during the times of Moses, God had told Moses and Israel, the entire nation, this is their principle of life. You shall open wide your hand to your brother, to the needy, and to the poor in your land. As long as they are in Israel, be generous. Open wide your hand. You know why? Because the opposite of that is being tight-fisted. Won't let go. I hold on tight to my money. Loosen your hand. Be willing to give. That's the principle for the nation of Israel. The Bible says, whoever oppresses a poor man insults his maker. You don't kick a poor man when he's down. But he who is generous to the needy honors him. You're generous to the needy. Now, some of you say, Singapore, where got needy? Very hard to find a needy man. Well, maybe because you've not been looking. I would say this, all right? Since we've moved to Punggol, it is a joy and privilege for many of our people to meet with those who are needy. I say it's a joy and privilege because it is a privilege for some of the gospelites here, you who have gotten to know the poor, to be able to serve the poor and give to the poor. Now, in a neighborhood like this, we have people from all kinds of background.
It's not superior to be rich. It's not inferior to be poor. It's how God has given us in our lot of life. We are contented in Christ. But the poor are people that God has given for us to have a privilege to serve and to exercise gospel generosity. And so I think my point is this. You say, where are the poor? Get to know people. If you're always isolating yourself, you just want a very clean kind of Christianity. I come to church, I watch a sermon, I listen to a message, I go home. No, you won't get to know the poor. You won't. Because you're not bothered to get into people's lives. But if you are actively developing relationships, perhaps God will give you opportunities to serve the poor. I hope as a church, we are working towards that progressively. We hope to get to know the neighborhood here in Punggol. Maybe there are some rental blocks here who may be indwelt by people who are struggling in life. And over time, I hope as a people, as a church, we would be able to bless and serve the community here more. But I think this is important for the Church of Jesus Christ. Even if we don't get to preach the gospel there, all right? Not like every time we give a voucher or we give a sack of rice, hey, you must sit down and listen to me preach the gospel. I don't think we should give with such hooks. We should give because we love them. Now, if they want to hear the gospel, they're willing to hear the gospel, we want to share. But let's not say, no rice until you listen to my gospel. All right, we should never do that. I think we should serve with a heart that generously loves. I want to show you other verses in the Bible. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Now, this is the early church some 2,000 years ago. Right after Jesus rose again, the Holy Spirit was given, and the New Testament church started there in Acts chapter 2. And one of the most amazing descriptions of the church then was that they sold their possessions and belongings and distributed for proceeds to all as any had need. I am always stunned by this statement. I say that over and over again in membership class and so on. I'm always stunned by this kind of description of God's people. Because I can think of what it means here in Singapore for gospel light. You have one landed property, two condos, three shop house, and you say, I'm going to sell that? Market no good, depressed market, why sell? Wait, no, they sold it. Got all the proceeds, and what did they do? They gave. Wow. You liquidated your physical assets so that you can give to the poor? That's what they did. I mean, that's phenomenal. We can say we love Jesus and so on and so forth, but I think they love Jesus. How do you know that? They gave. They were genuine in sacrifice. One of the best tests for Christianity is our checkbooks. Really. Pastor, you're so pragmatic, so practical, materialistic. No. It's very true. Later on in Matthew 6, you will hear Jesus say, where your heart is, or where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And how we use or steward the resources, money that God has given to us, is a very good way to tell us where our heart is. Well, they were generous, they gave. That's a mark of the early church. This is important in Galatians 2 that Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, the non-Jews. He said, when I conferred with the leaders in Jerusalem, they said, yep, you go. You go and share the gospel with all the Gentiles. But just remember this, okay? Just remember this. Remember the poor. I mean, of 10,000 things the Jerusalem church leaders could have said to Paul, they said, just remember this. One thing. Remember the poor. Which Paul himself eagerly said, I'm very keen to do. Sure, I will preach the gospel and I will make sure we serve the poor. It's important. in Ephesians 4, the Bible says, let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Now, I want to be very clear, this is not saying to be a Christian, stop being a thief, and then work hard to give to people. No, no, no. This is not an instruction to becoming a Christian. No. This is the result of being a Christian. If the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ dying and rising to save you from your sins is believed in your heart, you receive this message in your heart, you have been born again, you have been touched by the gospel, then this will be the result of your life. This will be the response of your life. This is the consequence of a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. What will you do? You'll stop being a thief. You'll stop stealing. By the way, the church is made up of all kinds of people. Thieves, homosexuals, immoral people. That's what church is, because all of us are sinners, right? But when you're touched by the gospel, you change your life because God is at work in you. Now, the gospel-touched man says, I'm going to stop stealing. And instead, I'm going to invest myself to diligent work. This is the Protestant work ethic. You work hard. You work hard with your hands. You do honest work. Why? Well, many Christians say, yeah, now I'm a Christian. I should not be lazy. I should not steal. I should work hard. But why do you work hard? So that I can buy my BM 6 Series. So that I can get my seafront villa. Well, very interestingly, Paul says, you work hard so that you can share. Work hard not so that you can increase the standard of your living, but increase the standard of your giving. Now, let me ask you this. Is this very bizarre to you? I know all of you are listening. Oh, good. Very good. Very good. Very good. Yeah, very, very biblical from the Bible. But I feel after you listen to this, very good, very good, but you still do the same thing. Seriously, I really think you might probably do that. Yeah lah, this one for the special Christian. As for me, I want to upgrade. HDB to condo, that's my dream, that's my life. What's wrong with that? Is that what you're thinking? If you laugh, I think it's so lah. Because that's what I think. That's what I think too. But that's not what I should think. And I think that's what it means to bring your imaginations and thoughts to the obedience of Christ. To regularly assess and check with our thinking. Is our thinking biblical? Because if you're not checking your thoughts, you will live the way you think. So I'm pausing here to say, guys, you really got to have a check for your own thinking, right? Time out. Don't just run in this Singaporean rat race. Don't just run in this chase for materialism. Time out and ask yourself, what is Christianity? Increase my standard of living so that I can have health and wealth? Or am I following Jesus, who gave everything up to seek and save that which is lost? I mean, really, who are you following if you say you're a Christian? Well, I could have said more, but let me just move on to 1 Timothy 6. Now, this is a very powerful passage. It says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, not to be proud, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. Many things here you can say. As for the rich in this present age, who are rich here in this present age? This one, honest to your heart. How many of you think you are rich in this present age? Materially rich. Can I see by show of hands? All you hypocrites. By any statistics, okay? By any statistics, Singaporeans, extremely rich. super rich. You go to another country, you can live like a king. Seriously. So how many of you are rich? We just preached about thou shalt not bear false witness, you know. Okay, I don't want you to raise your hands now. How many of you think you are not rich? Who is that hypocrite there? I think all of us are rich. I mean, maybe some are really don't have enough money even for rice and for bread. I do not know. I may have assumed. But maybe a vast majority here would be rich. And I think this verse applies to me, applies to you. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty. Don't be proud of your riches. Neither set your hopes on the uncertainty of riches. Ah, you see, I got a big account in my bank. I've taken care of my retirement. And for three generations after me, my children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, they hold their whole sale. I have 10 condos, they can stay all they want. Don't set your hopes on the uncertainty of riches. You know, I was just talking to my kids about how jobs may be lost in this world with technological disruption, right? You thought this career would set them for life? No more, you know. Even doctors can be no more, no. Actually, to me, it's like, why do you need doctors? Just get some symptoms key in a computer. Computer can help you, what? The computer can do everything to diagnose. Actually, we are all, actually, doctors are just high class. Well, okay, I mean, I used to be, I'm no more, so I can say whatever I want. But there are many jobs that will be lost, all right? So if you think that your kids are set for life, no. Even if you have a great job, war can take place, pestilence can come, SARS-3 can come. And so don't set your hopes on the uncertainty of riches. Who guarantees you'll be rich? And who guarantees your 1 million will be able to buy what you think a 1 million can buy? But the Bible tells us to set our hopes on God. Wow. The reason why so many of us are living materialistic lives is because we don't trust God. We don't trust that if we give to others, we will be provided. So we nge-nge, chio, everything chio, wow, snatch, wow, I want to get rich, I want to get this, I want to get that. Whole time talk about stocks, whole time talk about investments, whole time. No, I'm not against reasonable investments, I suppose. But is that your hope? Well, God says, don't do that. God provides us with everything to enjoy. Instead, those who are rich, this is what you need to focus on, all right? Not growing your net worth. This is what you should invest your time in. You should think about how to do good, to be rich in good works, and to be generous and ready to share. Why? Because thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future. You believe in eternal life? Now, if you don't believe in eternal life, then earn all you can, enjoy all you want. Go to every country in the world, tour, take picture, Instagram, come back, tell people I've had a great life. Why? Because after that, you're going to suffer. So better enjoy now. But if you believe in the eternal life, in the future life that is to come, don't you think it's smart to invest for that? Rather than have all your joy in this 80, 90 years, and then you suffer for all eternity? I mean, where's our brains? Well, the Bible is very clear. If we are not giving to the poor, James says, you don't really have real faith. Okay? I was baptized. I go to church. My parents are Christians, but I never give to the poor. It's okay. James say, what good is your faith? It's not real faith. If your brother or sister is poorly clothed, lacking in daily food, and one of you says, oh, God bless you, go in peace. What good is that? You don't have real faith. 1 John tells us, but if anyone has the world's goods, you have all the rice, or the vegetables, or the good stuff, and you see your brother in need, yet you close your heart against him, how does God's love abide in you? I mean, tell me, how can you say you know God's love and God's love is in you when you're hard-hearted and tight-fisted when you see others in need? So Jesus, when he talks about this religious activity, this is not a frivolous one. It's an important one. Throughout the Bible, the importance of giving to the poor. But I want to say, secondly, you've got to know the intention is also very important. It's not just what you give, but why you give. Today, people don't care about why you give, right? As long as you give me money, I'm happy. Isn't it? Charities don't ask you, hey, why are you so good? Give us money. They're happy. You give me 1 million. Who cares about why you give? But God cares. So the story we have read just now was about a man who went to the temple to give. Look at his yaya papaya posture. This is a yaya papaya posture, all right? He goes to the temple, he gives. You say, why does he give? He said, God, I thank... He actually never prayed. He's just talking to himself. God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, blah, 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 blah. Make sure everyone sees it, hears him. But the reason why he did what he did is because he trusted in himself that he was righteous. This is a story that Jesus gave. This man didn't give because he loved God. This man gave because he wanted to prove and to work his way to acceptance with God. He never gave because he loved God. He loved himself. And so Jesus also spoke about that wicked desire, using the plight of the poor to get praise and commendation from men. So why should we give? So don't just say, I give good enough. No, you should ask yourself, why do I give? And I think besides loving the poor, caring for the poor as a reason to give, real giving is for the glory of God. You give to the poor because you want to honor God. Whoever oppresses a poor man insults his maker. Whoever is generous to the needy honors God. And you give because you want to honor God. That is the most powerful motivation. Now, if you're not a Christian today, I can understand if you say, no, I don't believe in God, why should I give? Then that's fine. I can understand why you don't believe or you don't think this is a great motivation. But for those who really know God, I think you will know why you want to give, because God has given to you Jesus Christ, his Son. If you really understand how sinful you are, how amazing God's salvation is, you would give to honor him. One of the most fascinating descriptions of people is found in Macedonian church, is in a church in Macedonia. Paul says, I want you to know, he's writing to another group of people called the Corinthians, all right? So he's writing to them, telling them about the church at Macedonia. So he says, I want you to know, Corinthian brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia, in this place somewhere in Europe. For in a severe test of affliction, they were really in a difficult time, all right? They were under such affliction, yet there is this abundance of joy in the midst of extreme poverty. And what comes out from abundance of joy, extreme poverty, and severe affliction? They have a wealth of generosity. I mean, it's strange. They are under difficult situation. They are poor themselves. But they were very generous. They gave according to their means, and as I can testify, beyond their means. I mean, this is stretching them, really. But they gave beyond their means. And they even begged us to take the money to help the poor, the saints, the Christians who are suffering. Please take our money. But you're very poor. Doesn't matter, we want to give. But you're under trial. Doesn't matter, we want to give. Why? Because we're very happy to give. So why are they like that? Verse 5, And this not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord. They gave first of themselves to God. They recognize they are the Lord's. They didn't say, my money belongs to God, you know. I belong to God. When you have a clear identity of who you are, you can give. When you're not clear about who you are, you won't give. Because you think you have to fight for your life. You are the king of your life. But when you realize you serve the king, you don't have to fight for money. I'm not saying all of you be lazy. The Bible commands us to work a good day's work, honest work ethics, Protestant work ethics. But the motivation behind why we do what we do is totally different now. So I want to encourage you to have clear intentions behind giving. God. God-centered, gospel-centered giving. Lastly, I just want to end by saying the instruction for giving. Just one. There are many instructions in the Bible, but according to Jesus, just one instruction, and that is please give in secret. Now, the world's way of giving is not very secretive, all right? You have a president star charity, and whoever give your name, wow, you better take picture, the name will, the running name, right? As in, it's like a continuous tribute. Maybe people give today so that they will be covered in the media, such and such philanthropist gave, such and such company gave. Maybe you give so that your names are on a wall in a building or some plaques. You give because when you go to the charity gala dinner, your name will be mentioned. People like to broadcast the names and the identities of the givers. But the Bible tells me that when I give, I really don't want, I should not want that at all. I should give secretly. And I should tell the people I give, please don't tell others. Why? Because the temptation for pride is very real. We can't handle it, you know. I think this is very important for the church leaders. Church leaders must not, I think, all right, must not always actively source out who are the big givers of the church and then treat these as VIPs. Wow, you give this amount, better go and build relationship with you. That one give 20 cents. Yeah, bo chap la. That is clearly prohibited in the Bible. You know that? James chapter 2. Don't have that at all. And I think it's important, therefore, for church leaders to know that this is not what we should do. We should encourage the church to give anonymously. Really, I don't want to find out who gave what. Because I don't want that to shape the way I look at people and serve people and pastor people. That's the principle Jesus gave us. And I'm thankful all these years in Gospel Light, no giver ever comes to me, Pastor, you know how much I give or not? Next week in a Shine bulletin, please put my name up. Nobody has ever come to me to do that. And I think one of the most encouraging episodes in our church life was when we were embarking on a church building project. Now, the amount of money we had to raise was amazingly high, in my opinion. It's like, wow, where are we going to get that amount of money? And I'm thankful many of you gave sacrificially and secretly. Up till today, I have no clue how we made it. I have no clue. And I'm thankful I do not know who gave. Because your reward will be in heaven from your Father, not from us. I went to various churches. I asked various church leaders, what do they do when they have a building project? They tell me they hold church building dinners. One table, $10,000. Well, who want to come? But anyway, they say that's how they got the money, $10,000 or whatever. People will give for the food. They organize golf tournaments. They have names. They have rooms that may be named after big givers. They may have bricks that are named after big givers. They may have a plaque. And I say, when I hear all that, I say, never in this church, I hope, I pray. Number one, It's such a poor return for the giver's money. You give $1 million and have a name on a door. Wallah, for what? You really give $1 million to have a name? Go and build a house and put your name all over. It's easier. But give in such a way that your Father rewards you in heaven. Isn't that better? So, we endeavor. If you notice in this church, there is no human name from us attached anywhere in this building. This is a building that is meant purely for the glory of God. And I think it's not only for the glory of God, it's also for the good of those who gave. Your rewards are guaranteed in heaven. Well, I hope these are practical thoughts for you in your life. I hope you really will consider, if you have not been actively thinking about your life of mercy and generosity to the poor, think about it. It's important to give to the poor. Number two, give with the right motive. It should be a God-centered, gospel-centered motive. Number three, when you should now give, do it as anonymously as you can. All right? And again, I want to remind you, why do we give? Very simply, because God gave His Son for us. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's all because of Jesus. Jesus, though He was rich, yet for our sake He became poor so that you by His poverty might become rich. You know you're very rich? Christians, you know you're very rich? I'm not talking about material riches. I'm talking about eternal riches, spiritual riches for all eternity. You are an heir and co-heir with Christ. You know what that means? Bill Gates looked like a pauper. Bill Gates looked like a beggar. Because you're an heir and co-heir with Christ. God gave you everything. Most of all, reconciliation with Himself. And if Jesus gave that all up so that you can have all that, I pray, because of the gospel, you will give yourself back to Him. Let's bow for a word of prayer together. Maybe some of you are here today and you do not know Jesus as your Savior. I want to say to you, the Christian message is a message of giving. But it's not first about our giving. It's not primarily about our giving. The Christian message is about giving, yes, and it's primarily about how Jesus gave Himself for you. If you're here today, I want to say, God, Jesus Christ, He gave Himself to save you from your sins. You are absolutely bankrupt spiritually before God. You cannot stand before God based on your own works, but Jesus gave up heaven's glories, came to this earth, was born as man, so that He may go to the cross and die to pay for your sins. Now you can be rich. Rich spiritually, rich eternally, having this beautiful relationship with God, forgiven, cleansed, saved, adopted into His family. So this morning, I want to encourage you today to receive the gift of God, to repent of your sins and believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior. That's what this is all about, God's gracious gift to man. I received this gift some 20 over years ago, and my life has been changed. If your life has been changed by Jesus, then let me ask you, are you growing in a grace of giving? Giving to the poor. It's important. Why do you give what you give? How do you give what you give? I pray you will consider these things. But ultimately, let's do it because of the gospel. Because Christ first gave Himself for you. Let's ask God to purify our hearts that we may really love Him because He first loved us. So that in all that we do, it's not drawing attention to me, myself, and I, but it's drawing attention to our Father in heaven. All glory be His. Father, thank you for this day. Bless your word to every person here. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, thanks for watching. We hope it has been a blessing. For more of such content, do check out our website and our YouTube channel. And do subscribe for weekly updates. May God bless you.